This video is on impedance spectroscopy, the measuring of impedance as a function of frequency. What I have here is a little printed circuit board with two connections to it, which is an unknown impedance. I made up a number of these to use in the class for students to practice impedance spectroscopy with. Each one of these boards has on it a surface mount resistor, surface mount capacitor. They're connected either in series or in parallel, and each board is different, and I don't remember what the values are for any of the boards. I do have a table somewhere where I've recorded all the values so that I can check what students do when they measure them, but for now it's simply an unknown device, and we want to measure its impedance as a function of frequency in order to figure out what it actually has. So what we've got is the device that we want to measure. And it's usually called DUT, a DUT, which stands for Device Under Test. And we're going to measure the impedance by using the definition that impedance is the voltage divided by the current. Now, with the analog discovery 2, it's easy to measure the voltage. We can say, put channel 1 across the thing. Channel 1 plus, channel 1 minus, to measure the voltage. We can't measure current directly with the analog discovery 2. We can only measure voltage. So what we're going to do is add a known sense resistor. And we can measure the voltage across that with channel 2 in order to get the current through the whole thing. Because we were trying to do spectroscopy, that is to say, measure impedance as a function of frequency, we have to be able to put in sine waves of different frequency. And we can do that with waveform generator 1. So this whole setup can be done sort of automatically with a special board that Digilent makes to accompany the Analog Discovery 2, their impedance analyzer board, which has connector here for putting in the unknown impedance, some relays for switching which resistor is used, and some surface mount resistors here for being the sense resistor. But we don't really need that, and it's kind of overkill for a lab exercise. So we can do the whole thing on a breadboard. We've got our sense resistor here. I got a precision 1 kilo-ohm resistor here as my sense resistor. We've got the yellow and the black wires here to be the waveform generator and ground. We've got the two blue wires, the blue and the blue and white, to be channel 2, plus and minus, across the resistor. And we've got the two orange wires to be channel 1 across the device under test. And we can plug the device under test in to these two rows here. Let's take a look at the software, though, before we do that. Okay, first thing is we want to switch to the impedance analyzer. And we have a bunch of things to set up here at the top. First is the frequency range you want to use. I believe this thing was set so that the corner frequencies were somewhere in the audio range, just for convenience. So I'm going to test from about 50 hertz to, well, how can I go? Let's go up to 5 megahertz. If we do, say, 40 samples per decade, that'll give me 201 samples. Notice there's one more than just the multiple of the 5 decades here times 40 because of having to get both of the two endpoints. We need to also select the correct configuration of the wires. Here I had the C1 positive and C1 negative surrounding the device under test, so that's the setup I want to use here. Amplitude of 1 volt, that's a reasonable voltage range to use. You may need to adjust this if, for instance, you're using a very small sense resistor. You don't want to hit the current limitations of the function generator. with 1 kilo-ohm sense resistor, 1 volt is not going to cause any problems. The first thing we want to do, though, is to do compensation. Because we were using the breadboard here, we had long wires, and that means we've got a lot of inductance in series with our device. We've also got a lot of capacitance in parallel with the device. Also, inductance and capacitance on the resistance measurement as well. So we want to get rid of those errors in the measurement to the extent that we can. And the compensation pop-up here allows us to do this. For the 1 kilo-ohm sense resistor, I don't have any device plugged in right now, so I can do open compensation. And what this does is measure what the impedance is at each of those points. Right now, it is reporting the real and imaginary parts. I can change that, I believe, to reporting just the magnitude. The important thing to notice here is that we've got something that looks a lot like a capacitor, which is kind of what we expect. If it's an open circuit there, there's the capacitance, so the wires are what really matters. Now, if I short circuit where the device under test would be, putting in a very short wire there, I can do short compensation for the same frequencies. Notice that if we change the frequency range or the number of samples per decade, anything like that, we have to redo the compensation, because what it's doing is simply recording a value for each of the frequencies at which it's doing the measurement. Okay, now that we've done the open and short compensation, notice here now we've got something that's looking like it's very small resistances, going up a little bit with frequency, so there may be some inductance here. Take out the short circuit and put in the actual device I want to measure. And now close the compensation box and do a run here, where it is reporting currently both the real and the imaginary part of the impedance. And there seems to be a resonance there that's maybe messing things up a little bit for us. We can report the impedance here in different ways. Here we're just looking at, let's look at the magnitude of the impedance, and we can turn off the real part and the imaginary part. We've got the phase on the lower part of the screen here. We can also get it to report things like, well, what would the capacitance be? And it's reporting a fairly constant capacitance across here, except for this sort of weird glitch where it seems to be a resonance happening. And if we use the cursor, we can see it's claiming it's about 460 nanofarads. So, and that seems to be fairly constant across the whole range. All right, let's go back to looking at just the impedance here, and let's export this so that we can look at it with tools like Gnuplot. Now, we've got here frequency, the phase, the magnitude. Those are useful things to report. We can also add a comment here that this was token A33 and save this data as A33.txt. All right. Now we can go back to looking at this thing with Gnuplot. So let's do a little plot here. We had, now let's, before we do that, let's look just a little bit more at the waveform. We have a function here where the impedance is looking like a capacitor at low frequencies and then switching to looking like a resistor at high frequencies. And one of the first things to figure out is, well, is this a series connection of resistor and a capacitor, or is it a parallel connection of resistor and capacitor? And if we think about it, we would have a horizontal line for the resistor, diagonal line for the capacitor, and we've kind of taken the max of these two things. So that would be a series connection because we're adding the two things, and the smaller one hardly affects the result. So this looks to me like a series connection of a resistor and capacitor. We can guess the resistor here from just looking at the plot and saying, oh, it's somewhere around 470 ohms. And we just saw when we were looking in waveforms that it was around 470 nanofarads. So we can start with those as estimates. So 470 ohms, and let's go up here and try 470 nanofarads and see how that will do. We'll plot, we'll do a fit with this. So once we've, these will be our initial guesses, and then we will fit the series connection of the resistor and capacitor, and then plot the data and this series model. So let's do that. And look at the result. And we've got here very good fit down at the bottom here, pretty good fit across through here, not so good right at the end. Now if you look, I did do the fit just up to 1 megahertz, and that's because I had noticed in doing a practice run of this earlier that there's a little bit here at the high end, above 1 megahertz, maybe a little inductance or something that wasn't completely eliminated, or may actually be a real inductance that's there, but it's not part of the resistor and capacitor that we really want to model. So I just did the fit up to 1 megahertz in order to get a better fit for the resistance. And the values are 476 ohms, and it looks like more like 528 nanofarads rather than 470 nanofarads. So the capacitance was just a little off when we looked at what it was doing, you know, a little higher than what we had expected. This same approach we'll be using for loudspeakers and for electrodes. The modeling will be more sophisticated, a little more complicated for those devices because it's not a simple resistor and capacitor. But the measurement technique of setting up the system, measuring both the open circuit and short circuit values so that we can compensate for all our wiring, and then doing a sweep to measure the impedance at each frequency will be about the same. And we'll be doing fitting in a similar way, but with more complicated models for the fit. And that's it for this video.